My name is Rene Williams. I'm an assistant professor at the Molecular Photonics Group at the University of Amsterdam. And today we will discuss photoinduced electron transfer, and we will talk about the semi-classical Marcus theory. It is the third Nobel Prize winner in chemistry, Arrhenius. This is the Arrhenius equation, and it describes the rate as a function of temperature. The activation energy is here, and it also contains the pre-exponential factor. Now, the pre-exponential factor basically is the maximum rate that the reaction can attain, because if the activation energy is zero, then this becomes one, and so then you have the maximum rate. This rate is roughly 10 to the power 12, 10 to the power 13 per second. If you look at transition state theory, then it is kBT over h. If we plot the natural logarithm of the rate versus 1 over the temperature, then the slope gives us the activation energy. The Arrhenius equation basically contains two parameters, the pre-exponential factor and the activation energy. This is Rudolf Marcus. He got the Nobel Prize about 90 years later for developing the theory of electron transfer. Well, this represents Marcus theory. Marcus theory is based on two intersecting quadratic functions, and they represent the reactant and the product. The y-axis is energy. The x-axis is nuclear and solvent coordinates. You also call it the reaction coordinate. The Marcus equation, it contains three important parameters. The delta G, so the exergonicity, the driving force, the lambda, the reorganization energy, and the phi. Now the phi, that is the electronic coupling, it tells you something about the overlap of the electronic wave functions of the electron donor and the electron acceptor, the D and the A. It is a measure for the interaction between the two states. So here, these two states, they interact, they mix, the strength with which they mix, and that is related to the electronic coupling of the wave functions of the donor and the acceptor. Delta G, that is the driving force of the reaction. So how exergonic is it? What is the energy difference between the donor and acceptor in their neutral state and the state, the charge transfer state, in which we have the, which we have formed the radical cation of the donor and the radical anion of the acceptor? This should be lower. Mathematically, the delta G is just the delta Y value. So the Y difference between these two minima. The reorganization energy, a very important contribution from Marcus, it contains an inner sphere and an outer sphere. We have an internal or inner sphere reorganization energy, and we have an outer sphere, a solvent reorganization energy. The difference in nuclear coordinates, so the delta X of the two minima, if we square this delta X, then we get the reorganization energy. So it is the energy that is associated to converting one state into the nuclear coordinates of the other. So if we go from here, we go all the way up, this energy that is related to the change in nuclear coordinates. If we look at the pre-exponential factor of this equation, this is the rate of the electron transfer, then it contains this lambda and this electronic coupling. For the rest, just the constants, the Boltzmann, the temperature, pi, and h, Planck's constant. And in the exponential term, there we find the delta G and the lambda. So this is the classical Marcus expression, and it relates to intersecting quadratic functions, inner sphere and outer sphere reorganization energy, the reorganization energy that is related to changes in the molecule and changes in the solvent. If we compare the Arrhenius equation to the one of Marcus, then we see that they're actually rather similar. The pre-exponential factor, the A here, that is specified into different quantities like the electronic coupling and the reorganization energy. If we look at the exponential term, then we see the activation energy that is expressed in terms of driving force and reorganization energy, and it is based on quadratic functions. At the crossing point of two quadratic functions, it is related to the delta y and the square of the delta x. Now it has turned out that the classical Marcus equation, that it strongly underestimates the rate of electron transfer in the inverted region. In practice, the observed rates in the inverted region, they are much higher than predicted by this classical equation. Classical barrier is much too high. How to solve this? We have to take into account nuclear tunneling, also called the overlap of vibrational wave functions, vibrational mixing, or the Franck-Condon weight density of states. We have to take one step further. We go from the classical Marcus to the semi-classical Marcus equation. It's also called the Marcus-Jortner-Levich equation. We see that the pre-exponential factor, that is actually almost the same, but the classical contains the total lambda, the semi-classical contains only the solvent reorganization, so the outer sphere reorganization energy, not the total lambda. The second part of the equation, that has changed because it is now containing a summation of functions. And in the part of the activation energy, in this part, there we see that a vibration is now playing a role. And this vibration, it is a vibration of the molecule that mediates the electron transfer. It's also present here in this S function. That is what we call the Wang-Rice factor, which is the ratio of the internal reorganization energy and the energy of this vibration. So this here, actually, it is like a scaling factor. It reduces the intensity of the summation as M increases. The first proof of the Marcus inverted region that came from Kloss and Miller. They studied charge shift reaction, and they changed the nature of the acceptor and thereby changed the driving force, the delta G, Gibbs free energy change. So they changed that by changing the electron acceptor strength. This is the classical approach where we have a classical barrier that we really have to overcome. Now in the semi-classical approach, this implies the overlap of vibrational wave function. So that is this Franck-Condon factor. Not only the electronic parts play a role, but also the vibrational parts. Overlap of vibrational wave functions in the inverted region, it increases and it becomes more important, and that makes the rates faster. As you may know, the classical Marcus expression has made it into the textbook like Physical Chemistry of Atkins, and there it shows the classical way, this classical curve, the bell-shaped Marcus curve, where the rate versus the driving force is given. We have seen before in previous lectures that the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, which tells us that we can separate the electronic part and the nuclear part, that this approximation is not always valid in photochemistry, like for instance in the forbidden transitions of pyrene. Electronic transitions and vibrational transitions, they can influence each other, they can mix, and they can work together in what we call vibronic coupling. So this concept, this is expressed in Fermi's golden rule. Fermi's golden rule tells us that the rate is the product of an electronic part, the overlap of electronic wave functions, and a vibrational part, the overlap of vibrational wave functions. This last part is more important in the Marcus inverted region. This is basically the best way that we can represent this overlap of vibrational wave functions. So here we see the reactant state, the product state. We see all the vibrational wave functions that are drawn in. And this here in black, this is the overlap of the vibrational wave functions. Mathematically, it is the second part of this equation. The Franck-Condon term is the summation of these exponential functions with this scaling factor in front. This is the same equation that I showed you before, and this shows you this Franck-Condon factor in the normal region. This is the classical Marcus equation. We see that the rate drops very fast. Now in the semi-classical Marcus equation, the rate goes down more slowly, and it is due to overlap of vibrational wave functions. So this is in the normal region. This is the overlap of vibrational wave functions in the inverted region. And hopefully you see that here, the black area is larger. This overlap enhances the rate. We can encounter the semiclassical Marcus equation in various ways. It contains five parameters, this delta G, the solvent reorganization, internal reorganization, electronic coupling, and this particular vibration, a vibration that is related to the vibronic coupling. We can encounter it in other places, like in an ADF tutorial. ADF, state-of-the-art computational program, it uses, well, something that is basically the same as the semiclassical Marcus equation that I just showed you. The only difference is that in this case, this is not electronic coupling, but it's actually the matrix element for spin orbit coupling. So they apply it in a study related to thermally activated delayed fluorescence. So the triplets and the singlet play a role. But this part, mathematically, is the same as the semiclassical Marcus equation. Also, the Wang-Rice factor, you can calculate it with ADF, so that makes it very approachable. So here we see a three-dimensional representation of the classical Marcus expression. This here, at the z-axis, that is the rate as a function of the driving force, the delta G, at the x-axis. And on the y-axis, we have the solvent reorganization energy. So that is the x, the y, and the z. If we stay on the ridge of this mountain, then we stay in the Marcus optimal region. So there we have the highest rate that can be attained for these specific conditions. And you also see that the rates that you can attain are actually highest at small delta G's and small reorganization energy. It is within the Marcus theory, and people have observed that also. Actually, this here, it's not the classical Marcus expression, but it is the semi-classical Marcus expression, but then from M is 1 to 1. So just with one exponential term, but basically the classical Marcus expression looks the same. But now we can do a little trick. So we can see what happens if we increase M from 1 going to 2 and up. We go up to 3 all the way up to M is 15. And if you go beyond 15, then actually the influence becomes smaller and smaller. You see that the summation factor keeps on adding in the inverted region. This is how the semiclassical expression handles the overlap of the vibrational wave functions. So that is the way that the rate is increased in the Marcus inverted region. But you see that the extra additions, they become smaller and smaller as M here, as this factor in the summation, as it increases. And so you don't have to go very far. Now, the peaks in the background, they are, well, let's call them intriguing. And if we approach these peaks, we can just approach them. So now we see now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You see that the contribution becomes smaller and smaller. So now we approach these peaks in the back, and here you see them. If we approach these peaks, we actually see that oscillation starts to occur in the bell-shaped Marcus curve. I have found 3 old papers that describe these effects, but I would like to know more about this. Are these the limits of the semiclassical Marcus expression, or can we actually observe these effects experimentally, or maybe have they already been observed? We have made a trip from Arrhenius to Marcus, then onto the Franck Condon factors, where experimental proof, I think, is lacking for these kind of oscillations. We have visualized complex mathematical approaches made by Nobel Prize winners to show how the rate of a simple reaction the movement of an electron, how this rate is influenced by many factors. Thank you.